I remember an old church leader years ago. He was being interviewed on a platform. It just stayed in my mind. And I can't remember how the interview got to this, but it got to the issue of sexual temptation. Now, this guy at this stage was in his 60s. And he said, you know, you've been faithful to your, well, you've been married, I forget for how many years. You've been faithful all these years. How have you managed to do that? And this guy looked straight at the interviewer and said, because I know what God would do to me if I stepped out of line. There was for him a very healthy fear of God. And in our happy, clappy, charismatic, singing lots of loud and joyful songs and stuff, all of which is fantastic and I am totally in favour of, we can sometimes lose sight, and we began before we went into these, looking at these 10 words, we forget that we have a holy God.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called The 10 Words, Part 2, Exodus chapter 20, verses 13 to 26, by Pastor David Wise.
To help the people that weren't here last week, as we're going to come in partway through this passage today, what were the key things that we learnt last time? Yes.
We should honour our parents.
Yes. What else? You about to speak or just scratching? Just scratching. Okay. It's very dangerous. It's like an auction. Be careful what you do with your hands.
We should have individual commitment to God.
We need to have individual commitment to God. Yes. Very good. What else?
Everyone needs a Sabbath day, whether it's on the Sabbath or not.
Every single person, God's creation intention, the way he made us, is that we need a Sabbath day, a day of rest. Whether it's on a Saturday or a Sunday, it doesn't matter, but a part of our pattern needs to be that day of rest. And we looked about what we should do with that and use that for last time. What else? Timmy?
We should be aware and we should shy away from things that could become our God.
Yes, we need to just have undivided loyalty to the God, and we need to shy away, keep away from anything else that would displace him in our lives. And last time we looked at a whole list of things that could be. So yeah. Anything else?
Yeah.
Not to misuse God's name. We looked last time again how that doesn't just apply to swearing, but actually claiming God's on our side in situations. And we looked at some of the things, I referred to a few things in history as well, where people had misused God's name. Anything else? Okay, let's move on. Nice short verse. You shall not murder. Now the word that's used here, as you will, most of you will know, the Old Testament was written in Hebrew. And the Hebrew word that is used here that's translated murder is actually a very rare word. And so there's been a huge amount of debate about precisely what it meant. It's absolutely clear that it doesn't prohibit all killing. Because elsewhere in the law here, there is capital punishment for certain crimes. Also, all of the Israelite men had to be ready to go to war if necessary against God's enemies. And in war, you kill people. So it's clear that it doesn't mean under no circumstances should anybody ever be killed. So what is this about? Well, the principle behind this is that all human life belongs to God. Human life is sacred. Human life is sacred. We were all made in his image. We all have something of God about us. Whatever our physical appearance, our emotional makeup, our intellectual ability, we all of us are made equally, male and female, in the image of God. And all human life is sacred. It all belongs to God. So what is prohibited here is the, if you like, the unauthorized taking of human life, unauthorized by God. So that's the taking of human life in any context or in any way or any place that has not been authorized by God. And that has got a huge amount of moral and ethical implications, which we're not going to unpack in detail this morning. But here's some things to think about. How does this apply to our behavior in the West when it comes to issues like pollution and activities that add to global warming? Because by our actions here in the West, we are condemning people to death elsewhere in our world in a way that I don't think, I'm certain, God does not authorize. Where the actions of some people here result in the death of some people there. That clearly is something which is prohibited here. Huge implications. Other people draw implications out of this for issues such as euthanasia, abortion. Whole range of moral and ethical issues are all affected by the fact that human life is sacred. It all belongs to God. And how we apply that in different situations, Christians need to talk to one another and talk to God about and debate about together. But it is clearly a massive area, lots of implications from that. I'll leave you to think about that. Let's move on to the next one, verse 14. You shall not commit adultery. Adultery is sex with someone, if you are married, it's sex with someone other than your marriage partner. And we need to understand that from God's perspective, adultery is not just a sin against your marriage partner. It actually violates a part of God's intention for creation. And I want to just stray a little bit away from this and make a few comments about this. Because, you know, our culture here in the UK and elsewhere as well, but our culture here is sex obsessed. I mean, it's absolutely sex obsessed. Wherever you look in the media, television, magazines, internet, conversation, I don't know if you do what I do when you're sitting on the bus or whether you're in a public place. You listen to what people are talking about. I don't know if you do that as well. I don't mean it's about us spying on people's private conversations, but it's very interesting to know what issues people are debating. I look on some of the online chat forums, some of the ones that are discussing issues in the UK. See what are the things that people are concerned about? What are the issues? And this whole thing of people being sex obsessed is everywhere. And so we need to remind ourselves of a few principles here. We need to remind ourselves that God created sex. This was not some deviant idea that some human beings thought up. This was God's creation. And God said it was good. We also need to remind ourselves that it was good only in one context. And that was inside marriage. God created people, male and female. God created sex for procreation, for producing children, and I think for enjoyment as well. But it's only for inside of marriage. In any other context, in any other place, whatsoever, it is sin. And it is outside of God's creation intention for us. And it doesn't take a lot to think about, and I'm not going to ask you this question, but for just you to think about all the different ways that people are damaged and society is damaged and our world is damaged by people having sex outside of marriage. I mean, you can make a huge, huge list. I'm not saying that always those situations are not redeemable. I mean, I'm not trying to heap condemnation on people because of things they've done in their lives in the past. As we bring those things to God, those mistakes that we've made, those sins that we have committed, God can redeem that and turn that around. And there are people here who could give powerful testimony of that, sitting in this congregation. But we need to remember that God wants the best for us. So when God says to us, this is great, but this is the boundary, the reason for that is you go outside the boundary and the consequences are not good. I may have said last week that I get a bit fed up of people saying, well, you know, it's just me and them and it's in private, it doesn't affect anybody else. Please grow up. If you ever come and see me and say that to me, you'll know that I'm thinking, please grow up. That's the sort of thing that children say who don't understand anything about our world. Because as we've seen, we're not isolated individuals. Things that we do have consequences for people around us. And we need to be remembering that as well. And I could give you again loads and loads of illustrations of that. We'll leave that there. I want to explore this next one in a bit more detail and talk about together about this. You shall not steal. Theft, says one of the people I read this week, is an attack on the dignity of human beings and on their work. Now, I want to explore this a bit because, you know, it's very clear what adultery is. I mean, we don't need to have a long discussion about, you know, is this adultery or isn't it? It's crystal clear. But theft, stealing, is a lot more devious. You know, if I said to you, do you think it's wrong for you to break into someone's house and steal their possessions? You'd say, oh yes, absolutely. But the way that theft and stealing creeps around our culture, all sorts of different ways. So let's think together about some of those less obvious ways that people are involved in stealing and theft. Not the obvious things like, you know, snatching handbags from people or breaking into people's houses or taking their cars, but some of the less obvious ways that people steal. Denise?
Steal somebody's time.
Steal somebody's time. Could you explain that?
Like in my situation, I've got 5 children and everything else, and I've got a routine set out. Somebody could come to my home or get on the telephone with their own agenda and try to keep me there and keep me from doing the things that I need to do.
Okay, so you've got things to do for your children and with your children, and it's someone coming and taking a chunk of that time that is your children's time and taking it for themselves, not actually because they're actually in need, because you'd have no hesitation about helping them, but actually because they're just self-centred.
Yeah.
Okay, Carleen.
I was going to say time, but in another sense.
Okay.
Work-wise, people do, I mean, you're probably supposed to get to work at a certain time. Mm. If you know that the manager or whoever is not going to be there, oh, well, then they'll not know because they're not there. So I'll come in a bit later or I'll take a bit longer lunchtime or stuff like that.
Okay. So this is about stealing from our employer by not working the hours that we're supposed to be working. So, you know, the manager's not there to watch you, so okay, I'll come in a bit late, I'll have an extra long lunch, I'll go home early. So stealing from our employer. Okay, yeah, Trevor.
David, I agree with Denise, but again in another aspect. If someone makes an appointment with you and they roll up half an hour late, They've wasted a half an hour of your time. That is bad manners. It is rude.
Okay. So people who arrange to see you at a certain time, I'm feeling slightly guilty here because I missed an appointment with you. Really? I don't think I have apologised.
You phoned and told me.
I did phone and tell you. Yeah, that's true. So yeah, this whole thing of people that just make an... Okay, they make an appointment with you and they don't turn up and they don't let you know and they steal your time. Yeah, okay. Very good. Denzel.
When we perhaps don't declare all our income for tax purposes.
Okay. So who are we stealing from when we don't do that?
From the government, from the rules, and God has put government in place. Okay. That's what the Bible teaches us, so we should abide by that as long as it's not contrary to God's word, and that's not contrary to God's word.
Okay, so by not in lying on our tax form, basically, forgetting to put some things down... Yeah.
Or doing work privately, which you get paid for, but you don't actually declare.
Declare, okay. So all that, we're stealing from the government, which actually is us as people in the end of the day, because other people have to pay more taxes. Yeah, okay. Yes?
To follow on from Denzel's one, not tithing might be stealing.
Not tithing might be stealing.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you want to just unpack that in a sentence for me?
I
agree with you, but I'm not trying to set you up, so...
I think it's a command from God that we should give a certain amount of our income to the work of God. And if we don't do that, then we are stealing from God.
Okay, so if we don't give to God the proportion that he asks us for, we're stealing from God. And that's very biblical because God actually accuses the people at one point in the Old Testament of robbing him. So that's the same thing. Okay, yes, Frank.
I see it every day. People jumping on the number 18, the free bus, and not... swiping their Oyster card, same on the underground, people buying tickets or selling their ticket.
Okay, so this is not paying for your train fares, your bus fares and all of that. Again, that's stealing from everybody at the end of the day because everyone has to pay for that. Yeah, Leslie.
I think that people steal other people's peace of mind. Like, I'll give you an instance. Like, if you say that you're going to phone your parents, whatever, and they worry about you, one day goes, 2 days, their peace of mind's not there, and I think that's stealing from them, their peace of mind.
Okay, so because of our self-centeredness, we neglect to do things for other people that would bring them peace. So we steal their peace of mind. Very good. Ola?
Possibly stretching the perks of the job too far.
Stretching the perks of the job too far. So we're taking things from our employer that we're not supposed to be taking. They might say you can do this much, but we... take this much or this much. Yeah. Okay. Rachel.
You go to the shop and buy things and you realise actually they've got to charge you for something, not going back and saying.
Okay, so if you're undercharged on your bill or whatever at a shop and not actually talking about that. Okay, Andy.
Copying your friend's CDs or software.
Yeah. Yeah. Don't laugh, because this is true. Now when you copy someone else's CD or their software, you actually are stealing. It's not, and it's something which is, people in our culture think it's okay to do that, but it's not, because actually it is theft. And God says, do not steal. Caleb.
Yeah, just to expand on a bit what Andy said, the whole thing of piracy, whether it be, as you say, things to do with computers, CDs, DVDs, all forms of music, but photocopying as well.
Okay, yeah.
Because most material nowadays is protected under copyright.
Yep.
There's so no form of a book or something like that can be copied.
Okay, so making...
just one page would be okay, but...
Okay, so photocopying stuff you're not allowed to photocopy. Yeah, thank you.
I think sometimes we also steal people's respect by taking them for granted.
Okay.
When people go out of their way to do something genuinely, and then you keep expecting a person to keep doing it regardless of whether you still need that help or not.
Okay, so we take advantage of people by stealing their respect. Yeah, very good. Very good. Yeah?
When say one of your friends has an idea and then they tell it to you and then if you tell it to the teacher yourself, they're stealing their idea.
That's very good, yes. Somebody has an idea and you steal their idea by claiming that it's your own. When you pass that off at school or at work or at college or wherever else. Yeah, final one, yeah.
Making legislations and laws that steal from people's pockets, such as the council tax on TV licensing.
Okay, having legislation and laws that steal from people's pockets. I'd like to throw another one out for you, which hasn't been mentioned. As you, most of you will know, my passions is to do with justice for people in the so-called third world, or the two-thirds world. Now, when we buy produce that has been produced in some sweatshop, you know, we go to some shop and we pay £1.50 for our T-shirt or whatever it happens to be, I would like to suggest that actually we are stealing from these people elsewhere in our world who deserve proper payment in proper conditions. Which is why I, and as a church here, we're very much involved in the fair trade campaign. The tea and coffee you drank this morning, all fairly traded. We only use fair trade stuff within our church building here for tea and coffee and so on. So here's another way. So this is a big issue here. So we need to remember when tomorrow, next week, next month, when we're in one of these situations that we've talked about here, that God says this is stealing and you don't do it. Amen?
Amen.
That was a bit tentative. Amen?
Amen.
False testimony. Verse 16. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. Now, I want us to think about this as well, because this isn't just about going to court. You know, turning up in court and lying to get your neighbor into trouble. I was meeting with someone just a couple of weeks ago who was explaining in the country that they come from, this has become a feature. It's a way of persecuting Christians. Someone will go along to the court and say, this person has insulted our God. And people are going to prison for that. False testimony against their neighbor. Telling lies or telling misleading truth about our neighbours, people around us, is very destructive. It's just as destructive, by the way, when Christians dress this up. Charles, I was... It's all right, no, you say, I'm just using you as an illustration. It's okay, you can relax. It's okay. Deep breath now. Charles, I just didn't want to share this with you for prayer. Okay. I was talking to Fred last week, and they mentioned that. And I just want you to know, because I want you to be praying about that. So often people do that, and it is telling misleading truths or telling lies. It is doing someone else's character down. We need to be, just before I ask a question in a moment, we need to be very, very clear and very sure about our motives when we say anything negative about anybody else. There are times when it is appropriate to share things for prayer, and there are times when it is appropriate to come to the pastor or to the leaders of the church and say, I think you should know about this. There are times when that is appropriate. And the time that it is appropriate is when the motivation is for the best interest of the person you're talking about. When the motivation is anything but that, it's wrong. Do you hear me? So what other ways in our cultures that we live in, this whole issue of false testimony, how does it manifest? How does it show itself around? Because it is pervasive in our cultures in so many different ways. What sort of ways do we come across this? Linda?
I was driving along and I saw an accident in front of me, and somebody who caused the accident came running up to me and said, "You'll testify that it was his fault, won't you?" I said, "Well, no. I think it was your fault."
Okay.
So I did that.
All right. There's someone in an accident there wanting someone to be a false witness. Trevor.
David, unlike you, I listen to people on the bus. And, oh, the way I've heard people gossip about other people, even when they don't know the truth about the situation.
Yeah.
You know, and then when you talk to them and say, "How can you say that?" They say, "Well, it's not hurting anybody. I'm just talking."
Yeah. Okay. So just gossiping at other people. Yeah. Okay. Michael.
Creating what we call spin for the facts.
Spinning the facts. Yeah. So we take, that's what I talked about, misleading truth. We say something which may be true, but we say it in such a way that it creates a different impression. So that is false testimony. Denise?
Assuming you know the intention of why somebody said or did something.
Yes. So when we're talking about something that happened, people can dress it by saying, actually, when Denise did that, she was, and of course they've got no idea. So yeah, very good.
And people start lying through jealousy.
People lie through jealousy. Can you give me an idea of what you mean by that? So it's out of jealousy. People try and put you down because of jealousy. Okay. Busy here this morning. Adam.
Telling a lie because you believe it's going to be positive for the person. In other words, like a white lie that people say.
Okay, so
because you believe it might be positive.
So lying to cover up someone else's situation? Is that what you're saying?
Possibly. But, you know, saying a lie that you think will help the other person, but not really.
Okay, all right. So, yeah.
Like the testimony I made at the accident that I had, there was the neighbor's husband who wasn't even there when the accident happened. But he came and he took a look at me and the other people and decided that it must have been my fault, even though he wasn't.
Okay, yeah.
So during the chatting in the house now, in Mrs. Ali's house with his wife said, actually, my husband said, it was your fault. And Mrs. Ali said, no, it wasn't her fault.
Okay. All right, so the whole thing there about accidents and so on. Yeah, Belinda.
Sometimes we tend to try to be loyal to people that are close to us or that are friends. And in the process, we could be giving a false testimony against somebody else.
Okay, so trying to be loyal to a friend of ours, we can actually bend the truth in their favour, but that's against somebody else.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. One of the other situations that crossed my mind was the situation of people at work who are after position or after promotion. And they will want to, I'm not talking about the Greenford Baptist Church staff here, we don't promote people, but in other contexts where you might want to put somebody down, all right, to get yourself further up, yeah? Or to put somebody else up to get someone you don't like down. You know, the whole false testimony thing of manipulating. That resonated with you, didn't it? Yeah. The whole thing of that false testimony about other people to try and change the dynamic there within the work context. Okay, false testimony. Let's move on to the next one, verse 17. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, his manservant, maidservant, ox or donkey, or anything else that belongs to your neighbour. Now this action here, this heart action, is at the root of many other things. And what this is in essence, this is about a person's dissatisfaction with their own possessions and a desire to try and obtain stuff that belongs to somebody else. One of the hallmarks of our society here is about greed. People not being satisfied with what they've got and wanting more. Whether it's more money or better holidays or a bigger house, or a better car, or whatever. It is that whole thing of greed, which is the outworking of coveting. Coveting is the heart action, the heart attitude. So let's think again around, about our society, about our contexts. How does this coveting, this desire, dissatisfaction with someone's own possessions, using that in the wider sense, desire to try and obtain what belongs to someone else, how do we see that showing itself around us in our society? What sort of ways? Rachel?
I just think about, I'm terrible at watching these programmes, House of the Country or whatever, you know, and stuff, we wish I lived somewhere that's a bit prettier than Greenford or a bit bigger house or whatever, and it can leave you so dissatisfied with your lot rather than being thankful God for everything he has given you, you lose the thanks to God because you
become. So as we look at the pictures of something else, we think, oh, that would be nice. And we forget actually how God has blessed us in our own context. Anita?
When God calls somebody to something and he gives you a particular calling, somebody not satisfied with what God's called them to do and wanting to be a different calling for somebody else within the church.
Okay, so someone who's not satisfied with the ministry which God has given them, that role, actually wanting, being jealous, coveting someone else's role and place within the church. Yes. Denise?
Well, the other Ten Commandments that could cause you to lie, steal, murder, lots of different things can come out of coveting. I've really, really thought about that word coveting and tried to work out what it actually meant. Is it like looking at somebody's thing and saying, oh, that's nice? Or is it like going beyond your means to try and get that thing or making it fester in your heart that you feel that somebody else shouldn't?
The distinction is this, you see. If you've got, let's just say, you look at, we'll go with a house illustration. You know, you see someone's house, think, that is nice. Yeah. That is great that God has blessed them with that. Yeah. There's nothing wrong with that at all. Thinking, that's a nice house. That is great that God has blessed those people. Where it becomes wrong is when we think, actually, that's a nice house. Why am I stuck in this rubbish house that I've got? And God has blessed them with that house. I want that house. I mean, I'm putting it in big letters here. But see, the difference between appreciating God's blessing on somebody, like the illustration that Anita gave. We could look at someone else's ministry in the church. So that's fantastic. Isn't it great that God is using them and blessing them? I mean, Bowler, when he led worship this morning, wasn't that fantastic? Didn't he do well this morning in leading the way that he led this morning? God's minute, you know, God's anointing is upon him. And we can appreciate that and thank God for him. But if you're sitting here thinking, that's just not fair, that Bowler's leading worship like that, and I don't get that opportunity, that's coveting. Yeah. Does that make that clear? Thank you. Caleb?
I think also, as you say, if you're coveting someone else and you want to don't go that one step further, you slip into pride.
Yeah,
you can get too wrapped up in pride and making yourself look better than other people and forget where God brought you and what he's given you.
Yes, so coveting leads to pride, it leads to lots of other things. Yes?
I'm thinking of a situation where this dissatisfaction is actually created by preachers when they... When they talk prosperity in such a way that they create in you a situation where they're saying, if you don't have this, then you're not there. And then you start looking yourself and you think, okay, this one has got that, then I must have it.
Yes. So this whole thing, you're right. I mean, this prosperity gospel that gets preached sometimes, where there is this thing, if you really are with God, God's going to bless you financially. You know, when you read the Bible, if you ever get tempted by that, read Hebrews 11 and have a look at those great people of faith who went around living in holes in the ground, wearing animal skins, getting sawn in half. They experienced God's blessing. It wasn't fat bank accounts. It wasn't Mercedes. It wasn't all of that stuff. God does sometimes bless us with material things. All of us here in this building, I don't care how poor you think you are, in terms of our world, you are stonkingly rich compared to the rest of the world. You know, and there's nothing wrong with recognizing that's God's blessings, but it can then lead to coveting. If we get into that sort of idea that, well, their faith must be better than mine because they've got a bigger car than me and all of that. Thank you very much. Yeah.
People, I think, generally sometimes we're not happy with our own looks. And you look at someone who is beautiful or someone that's nice, you start commenting, why are they so beautiful? And look at me. And I think that's...
Okay, so not content with how God has made us, but thinking that other people are more beautiful, more athletic, whatever it is, and all of that. And we looked a bit of that last time. Was it last time or sometime recently? We talked about the whole thing of wanting to be youthful all the time. And it's this idea then, and that is about coveting something that is not ours. Okay. Anything else? Yes.
Just came to my mind. Sometimes someone can be dissatisfied when you compare yourself with other people.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe ordinarily you might just feel I'm okay, but when you start looking at other people and you know comparing, I don't have that kind of shoes, or I don't have that kind of money, my little dissatisfaction subsequently.
Okay, so when we compare ourselves to other people, we can then begin to be jealous, coveting stuff that other people have got. Right, final two, Joan.
I think in some ways the lottery can link into this, in that it gives us a dream. I say us, I don't do it.
You don't buy lottery tickets.
So I shan't be able to win it. not likely that I'll win it. But it gives us a longing for a lifestyle and a future that God hasn't given us.
Yes, this whole thing actually is a good illustration of the lottery and a lot of the other stuff with gambling that is around that. It actually feeds off people's greed and it feeds off people's covetousness. Because it feeds off people not being satisfied with what God has given them and thinking, if only... Yeah, finally.
Yes, it's, somebody else's partner, as in relationship, wanting, because I always get this, that how beautiful I am. But, seeing somebody else's partner and saying, I want that, which then leads to adultery, which then leads to other things that...
Yeah, coveting the other person's partner. Okay, thank you very much. All of these things. And I think one of the other things, I'm going back to this justice issue, because a lot of the time that we've used this here today, we've used it about people who are wanting to take stuff from people who have got more than they've got. But it also works the other way around. Can work the other way around with those with power taking from those without. And that can equally be coveting. Taking the smaller person's possession, place, whatever it is, using their power, their authority, their influence to take from somebody else. It's not just about, poor people wanting stuff that rich people have got, but actually rich people taking stuff that poor people have got. And there's a whole justice thing here. And that's, again, it's a big issue to do with trade and wages and all sorts of issues around that as well. Let's move on. Last part of this chapter, verse 18. When the people saw the thunder and lightning and heard the trumpet and saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and said to Moses, "Speak to us yourself and we will listen, but we'll not have God speak to us or we will die." And Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. God has come to test you so that the fear of God will be with you to keep you from sinning." The people remained at a distance while Moses approached the thick darkness where God was. There's two sides to this. There's fear that is here. Some of the fear here was wrong. Some of the people's fear was wrong fear. Now, God invited them, come closer. And they didn't because they were afraid. They were aware of their lack of holiness. They're aware of their sinfulness. And so they were frightened of what God might do to them. Now that's a lack of trust in God. But there is a part of their fear that actually is right and appropriate. Because the fear of God can keep people from sinning. I remember an old church leader years ago. He was being interviewed on a platform. It just stayed in my mind. And I can't remember how the interview got to this, but it got to the issue of sexual temptation. Now, this guy at this stage was in his 60s. And he said, you know, you've been faithful to your... Well, you've been married, I forget for how many years. You've been faithful all these years. How have you managed to do that? And this guy looked straight at the interviewer and said, because I know what God would do to me if I stepped out of line. There was for him a very healthy fear of God. And in our happy, clappy, charismatic, singing lots of loud and joyful songs and stuff, all of which is fantastic and I am totally in favour of, we can sometimes lose sight, and we began before we went into these, looking at these 10 words, we forget that we have a holy God. Do you remember that before God spoke, there were these boundary around the mountain? And God said, you cross that, you die. Because I'm a holy God and you are an unholy people. And there was that boundary that was put there. And we looked and explored something of God's holiness. And that fear of God can help us stay out of sin, because we recognize that sinful behavior has consequences with God as well as people around us. Let's read these last few verses 22 down to 26. The Lord said to Moses, tell the Israelites this, you've seen for yourselves that I've spoken to you from heaven. Do not make any gods to be alongside me. Do not make for yourselves gods of silver or gods of gold. Make an altar of earth for me and sacrifice on it your burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, your sheep and goats and your cattle. Wherever I cause my name to be honored, I will come to you and bless you. If you make an altar of stones for me, do not build it with dressed stone, for you will defile it if you use a tool on it. Do not go up to my altar on steps, lest your nakedness be exposed on it. What I find fascinating, just before we get into the detail of some of the odd things in these verses, is how in the center of all of these 10 words, what God said at the beginning, what God said at the end, the central thing is the relationship between God and his people. This is not about a list of rules with tick boxes. You shall not steal. Yep, done that. You don't covet. Yep, tick that one. Tick this one. Tick that one. It's not about external rules and regulations with tick boxes. It's about relationship between God and his people. He wants the best for them. The best for them actually is about them being obedient to him, honoring his words. And at the center of all of this revelation and their response is the relationship between God and his people. And that still is the same today. It's about our relationship with God. These are laws here about plain altars and about dress and so on, was about their worship being in marked contrast to the worship of the people around them, who often had, or in fact usually had, very elaborate altars, and often the worshippers also were naked in their worship because their worship included sex. And God is making clear, the way that you worship me, it's not like your neighbours worship their gods. So I want none of that in your relationship with me. That's what these things are about. Our time is nearly gone. let's begin to draw these things together. What are the key things that we take away from this second part that we've looked at this morning, verses 13 down to 26? What are the key things that we take away? Because it's not about what we think this morning. I say this to you often, but it's not about what we think this morning. It is about how you behave this week and next week. It's not enough to have come and heard. It's about changed lives and changed lifestyles. So what are the things we take away back into our work situation, our home environment, our families? What do we take away from this morning? Leslie?
That stealing isn't just necessarily stealing someone's money. It's a whole, you know, genre of things.
Okay, stealing is a whole, as you put it, a whole genre of things, a whole wide things. It's not just about nicking someone's cash. It's a much broader thing than that. Is Matt?
Fear of God keeps us away from sinning.
Fear of God keeps away from sinning. Wayne?
No matter how poor we think we are exceedingly rich.
No matter how poor we think we are exceedingly rich, yeah.
Without conviction and the fear of God, there'll be no change.
I didn't catch that. Say that again.
Without conviction, which is what I believe the Ten Commandments are there to do, there won't, and the fear of God, there will be no change.
Okay, without God convicting us, challenging us, and without the fear of him in that, our lives won't change. Yes, I saw a hand back here.
I think, as a whole, it gives us a better understanding of, you know, the whole commandments. Gives us a better understanding of God himself, what he likes us to do, the way he likes us to live.
Okay.
And what he expects us, you know, from us as his children. So I think it just gives us a better understanding of the way we should look at God and, you know, what he expects of us.
Okay, so we take away from this a better understanding of what God is like and what he wants for our lives. Yeah, very good. Thank you. Trevor?
Think of what effect your action, thought, word or deed might have on somebody else before doing it.
Okay, think about the effect of what you're going to do, what you're thinking, its effect on other people. Anything else? Yeah.
Worshiping God in spirit and in truth, and not just eye service to God.
Not just eye service to God, yeah, but spirit and truth, whole life service to God. Worship is about every part and aspect of life. Yes, very good. Anything else? Rangina?
Staying in close relationship with God.
We need to stay in close relationship with God. It is about that relationship, isn't it? It's not about the list of, as I put it earlier on, the tick boxes. These were the things that came out of it, particularly for me, just reflecting on our culture. Any place for sex is within marriage. This whole thing about what we say. James talks about the tongue being a fire. We need to be very sure about our motives for speaking. And all of this in the context, all these other things, are in the context of God wanting the very, very best for us. Let's stand together. Let me pray for you as we finish today. We don't have a meeting of any sort this evening. So let me pray for you. Pray God's blessing upon you as we come to an end. Let's take a moment, first of all, of quiet. You may want to make a response to God yourself. There may be something you want to say to him now in the silence. I'm going to give you a moment to do that, then I'm going to lead us in prayer together. Father God, I thank you that you are a God that does want the best for us, and that you're a God that doesn't leave us in the dark guessing what we ought to do. But you are a God who speaks into our lives and situations. We thank you for these 10 words, these 10 commandments, and all their implications for us in our life and lifestyle. Father, I ask you to help us to live lives that are visibly different for people around us, that we will be, in our context, salt and light, that people will see our lives and see something of you expressed in our lives as we serve you, that we will be different people. Father, help us this week in whatever situation we find ourselves in, whatever context we find ourselves in, when we are tempted to go against your word, to go against what you ask of us in any situation or place, to remember to stay faithful to your word, remembering that you want the very, very best for us. And so, Father, I ask for everyone here this morning that you will pour out your Spirit upon them as we finish today. You'll anoint them as they go into this week. Whether they go into this week to work, whether they go into this week be at home with their children, whether they're going on a holiday, whatever their context or place, wherever they're going to be this week, they will know the blessing of your Spirit in their lives and through their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Please sit down. We finished this morning. If you've got children in creche or Sunday club, you need to go and collect them.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.